Bob is the...
he's going to turn it on. Thank you very much, Sadiq. I'm glad it was shorter than last night's. It's a certain amount of exaggeration. But I'm very happy here. Now, I have the great honor to be here to join you today. Looking forward to your questions. So I've been given the task in just 15 minutes to introduce Islamic law. So let me proceed at once. Here's what I'm proposing to discuss. By the way, I'm just trying to set a sort of a basis for the speakers to come who will be able to answer further questions you have. First, I'm going to talk about Islamic law in one sense, that of the received classical law, so to speak, mostly Sunni. The law that was given final sort of statement, you know, just before the sort of modern, you know, the early modern times, leading up to early modern times, from, of course, the time of the Prophet. Secondly, I want to cover number two. Sorry, should be number two. Number two, I want to cover something often left out, but won't be left out today, and that is what sort of legal system applied this law. Very crucial to know something about that, as well as the content of the law. And then thirdly, what happened to that law in the colonial times? You probably are not unaware that the Islamic legal systems were largely abolished or dismantled at the in the era of colonialism, and something else has taken its place. The states that we see around the world, Muslim states, actually don't apply Islamic law that broadly. So I'll give you an idea of the varieties of states out there. So first, talking about Islamic law, how itself presents. If one asks someone, most Muslims today, what is Sharia, they don't necessarily come out with their own view of justice or what is good, true, and beautiful, or they don't repeat that this is divine plan for all of humanity, or things like this, or evolve their own Sharia. They will tend to point toward the intellectual product of centuries of work by scholars. So the scholars, the jurists over the ages, have elaborated an Islamic law from the Quran and the Sunnah, the Quran being the divine book revealed to Muhammad, and the Sunnah being being the Prophet's example from his lifetime, which has been recorded and acts in a way as a second scripture. So they tend to say that the Sharia, as best they can tell, they know, is what these scholars have said it means after centuries of study. Now, that law tended to take its present articulation by the 13th century. It has continued to develop, as I'll explain later. So this, again, is represented as the product of a 7th century revelation. Theoretically, nothing is added to Sharia since the 7th century. The Quran and the Sunnah are its sole material bases. Everything added would be merely interpretation. Now, of course, if one wants to take seriously Sharia's aspiration, which I should emphasize, that it should govern all of human acts, every step one takes, one should be guided by the divine revelation, the divine law. Then if one turns to the Quran and the Sunnah for answers for every single act that you might take, whether it's legitimate to drink Coca-Cola, whether it's legitimate to do this or that, you know, to dance, to do this, to do that, if you turn to the Quran and Sunnah, you may not find an explicit rule. 99.999% of the time you won't. So the scholars, taking seriously this aspiration, sought to elaborate from the Quran and Sunnah rules for every human act. They only covered a certain number of them, very few actually, and they produced a lot of books full of rulings, but still even those need to be applied to specific acts. So it's a huge effort of interpretation that's required. Now, it was understood that since this interpretation is not divinely revealed, it is human infallible. So you have to be aware of a distinction between two terms that are both translated into English as Islamic law. One, Sharia, which is the divine perfect law. What we know of it is revealed by the Quran and Sunnah, they say. The other is fiqh, meaning jurisprudence or understanding, literally, which is what humans have been able to understand of the divine law through the study of the Quran and Sunnah and various ones and interpreting it. So how do humans get answers from the Quran and Sunnah through a process that is called ijtihad? There's a saying by the Prophet, he was sending an emir to Yemen. He said, by what will you judge And the man said, well, by the Quran. He said, what if you don't? Prophet says, what if you don't find anything there? Well, by your example. What if you don't know of any? Ejtahid bi ra'yi. I will use my sound opinion. I will exert myself, ejtihad meaning exert oneself, to reach a sound opinion. The Prophet approved of his view. Now it's recognized that these interpretations remain uncertain, being human. They don't have the status of revelation. There's a clear divide. So they're uncertain. They don't have that certainty that divine revelation brings. But they felt that uncertainty was sufficient as a basis to govern action, not belief, as someone will explain later, but action. The idea being that if somebody you walk by and someone is under a sloping wall, in those days walls had a tendency to collapse, somebody's under a sloping wall, you say, you must move. He said, well, why should I move? So, because the wall's going to fall. How do you know it's going to fall? It might. So out of a feeling of caution, the best possible guess at the divine law is the best guide for action. One is obliged to follow that best guess. Now, there are rules for how to perform ijtihad. These are called usul al-thaq, which will be discussed later today. The roots of the jurisprudence. There are four sources. The Quran, of course, which actually literally covers only a relatively few rules, and even then there are many issues of interpretation for application. Second, the Sunnah, which is more voluminous and actually very contested internally because these statements about the Prophet had to be historically authenticated. They're from a 22-year period of people observing the Prophet. Then they go through the problems of eyewitness testimony and there's contradiction and so forth. And then thirdly, ijma', meaning the agreement of scholars on a point of law in any single age. Actually, the requirements for that ijma' or consensus are so high that it rarely occurs. But there's an undeniable retrospective tendency because of ijma'. You tend to look back to see whether scholars differed in the past to know whether you can differ now. And then the fourth root is qiyas, meaning analogy. There's a huge debate whether there's any role for human reasoning at all in the interpretation of the Islamic law. Finally, they settled, after very extensive interpretations when things were freer, when they got down to writing down their method, they could only agree ultimately on analogy, which is a very modest, it's almost an inescapable process. If the Prophet ruled that you can sell a donkey on credit, it's impossible not to think you can also sell a horse, and so forth. So this is a very modest form of interpretation. But because this became the sort of sanctioned method of interpretation, the method of writing became casuistic. You open a book of Islamic law, you find a series of instances that are to guide the judge. But as you read those, you will be confused. You'll think this is very disparate. But behind it are actually operating a lot of jurisprudential principles. Some of them enshrined in Revelation, but many evolved by the judges, which actually provide a coherent framework behind the scenes. Now, if everyone were in mujtahid, that means somebody who's capable of practicing ijtihad, this interpretive process, there would, of course, be a huge cacophony of views, and there was in the early ages, in the early periods. In a sense, it continues right down until today. All of them equal claims on the truth of the revelation because there is no revelation to disprove them by definition. So there was necessarily a sense of toleration of each other's views unless one could mount the proof that God had actually sanctioned only one view. So there's this cacophony. So the idea grew. Well, first, lay people, of course, weren't capable of this, participating in this cacophony. They needed to follow those who knew more. So they practiced what's called taqlid, which is to follow the opinion of another human being because he knows more than I do. This was common, of course, among lay people. The idea spread that it should be practiced also by scholars and that they ought to organize themselves behind particularly leading lights. And they started to do this. And you ended up with four schools of law, all following, purporting to follow certain great leaders of thought from the earliest centuries, Abu Hanifa, Malik, Shafi'i, and Hanbali, and Ahmed ibn Hanbal, creating four schools, and by the 13th century, those four alone remain standing. And then, when you have a school of thought that tends to be applied in the courts, people start adopting that school of law, so you ended up with geographical strongholds for each of these schools of law, and you can sort of chart them on a map. For example, North Africa and Spain were Maliki, far eastern landlocked regions of the Muslim world were Hanafi, Southeast Asia was Shafi, and so forth. Now, the Shia have a law that actually resembles the Sunni law in most respects, except for a few areas that have political significance. But in many respects, they are like another school of Islamic law, and that's true of the various Shi'i groups. Now, everyone hears the term closing of the door of ijtihad. What happened was, when it became accepted that you should follow a school, in a way the door of ijtihad was closed. In other words, the further the liberty to continue to reinterpret the Quran and Sunnah independently was really closed off, because people should follow another thinker. But yet, all sorts of degrees of ijtihad, even ultimate ijtihad, remained existent. And the closing of the door of ijtihad mostly pertained to lower levels of the hierarchy. Even at the top of the hierarchy, a scholar may acknowledge that he is Shafi or so forth, but he is mostly following certain precepts of Shafi and independently thinking in all other respects. And interpretation and innovation continued, but with an undeniable exaggerated respect for the past, no doubt. So now let's talk about the system that applied this law, a vital thing that is often forgotten. It's essential to know something about the U.S. legal system, for example, that it's a democracy or a republic that has 50 states. If you were trying to open a book hundreds of years from now, American law, and you didn't know those facts, you would quickly be confused. So some strange things about this account of fiqh that I've given so far. It's very implausible as the basis for a legal system. What I've said so far, it's a bunch of jurists sitting in their studies, absorbed in the Quran and Sunnah, and trying to interpret them based on verbal means, including analogy and so forth. Where is the reference to sort of contingent facts on the ground? Where is the reference to struggles for power within a state? Who's going to make those, you know, sort of absolutely contingent decisions, like what the tax rate should be on such and such customs from such and such port? Obviously, much has to be decided in some other way. I've got lost here. I'm not very good at this thing. Okay, so now, this actually was what happened in fact. I mean, it was not what happened in fact. What happened from the beginning with the early leaders, the early rulers, and the early empires was that they evolved the law in all sorts of ways, not the purely juristic. They reached very much many practical solutions. They tried to respect the Quran and Sunnah. They implemented those laws, often in a way as legislators and certainly as rulers. And judges were an essential part of that process. Scholars contributed and so forth, but it was understood that the ruler, if anything, epitomized the Islamic legitimacy. But there came a time when the jurists began to gain on the ruler. And then, retrospectively, they have reinterpreted Islamic history as if it were their own creation from the start. This belies hundreds of years of vital history. This accomplishment is particularly, we should attribute to Ma'wardi in about 1058, about 4.5 centuries into the Muslim era. He made fiqh the constitutional law of Islam, and reached out with fiqh to govern fiqh itself, the scholars, through the product, to govern the entirety of the Islamic State, in a way, pushing scholars and their jurisprudence to the top of the legitimacy hierarchy. And this doctrine eventually became called Siyasa Sharia. It represents a huge delegation to the state to do many tasks that are essential to the upholding of Islamic law, but weren't governed, nor could they ever be governed, by mere jurists. So in a way, Sharia, fiqh, granted flexible authority to the state to act legally on two conditions. One, its actions serve the public good, the general good. And second, there would be no fundamental contradiction to Sharia, which is not the same as elaborating from interpretation from the Quran and Sunnah a ruling for every act. Very different method. The result was a dual system that fiqh essentially governs this left side of the spectrum, the scholars and the fiqh, and the ruler and siyasa govern the right side. The public, private, and civil, largely under the control of private scholars, whether or not they're operating merely as scholars giving opinions or as judges appointed by the state, in any event, they applied largely their own law. On the other side of the divide, the ruler was operating through the siyasa, a liberal siyasa method to govern in fact, and changes and circumstances and so forth were largely governed, were largely managed, regulated through his activity. And you can see how the bodies of law tend to divide down the middle. Fiqh tends to sort of peter out, except for some precepts, typically Quranic or Sunnah, that extend into the right side of the spectrum. But otherwise, everything on that right side is largely governed by ruler practice after a few, from the beginning, actually. Now, interestingly, and it'll come up today, a large part of the actual practice of Muslims, even normative, normatively governed, was done through the Siyasan means and is largely unwritten and inaccessible to us, and one is misled if one thinks that the fiqh norms apply full stop in that area. This is often forgotten. This system lent stability, constitutional stability, to Islamic states for a millennium, and it still endures today in several states. Okay, what happened in the colonial era? This system was rapidly dismantled, shockingly fast. The key case was the Ottoman Empire, which rolled back Islamic law and ultimately ended in, at the end of the First World War, in the secular, in Turkey declaring itself a secular state, an accomplishment that is rare, if non-existent, in the Muslim world yet fulfilled. Now, it's interesting to note that the changes progressed from the right side of my spectrum. Oops. Toward the left. These codifications, this pushback by Western law of Islamic law proceeded from the right to the left. In most countries, it ends up ultimately at the family law area, all the way almost to the left, leaving a redoubt of Islamic law application in matters of family and, of course, private ritual. When this process was finished, you end up with a few types of state. First, the secular state, Turkey. Indonesia, to some extent, although it acknowledges a divine authority, Pancasila. Second, the semi-secular states, like the great majority of Muslim states, which are the ones I essentially just described, the colonial transformations under the aegis of Sharia and the Siyasa, under the legitimacy of Siyasa, pushing back Islamic law, adopting laws that were generated on the authority of the ruler, which just happened to be largely Western in content and form. Siyasa being the authority for accomplishing that. And a narrow sphere being left for the family law, and even family laws denatured by the state nationalizing it and codifying it, not leaving it open to the interpretation of scholars. So these states end up Janus-faced to their populations. They can claim to be Islamic, to those who care. To outsiders, they can claim to be just as secular as any other, leaving everything except religious observance and some aspects of family law entirely to secular law and principles. Now then there are states like Lebanon, Nigeria, and so forth, where there are many denominations besides Muslim, and there are generic constitutions that govern the rights of all, but recognize these native laws or local laws or personal laws. Then there are traditionalist states, ones that largely escaped this colonialist transformation, largely Saudi Arabia and Afghanistan. And these still are framed and represent the old constitutional theory, and fiqh has relatively broad application. And then there are so-called radical Islamizing states, we call them various things, Iran, Taliban, Afghanistan, Sudan, which attempted, largely forgetting that there was ever a Siyasa, to reapply fiqh. So, and they also saw the Islamic State as the crucial tool for the implementation of Sharia and fiqh across the board, which it had never been. So this is in a way to distort history, and I would say for that reason they have also, in my view, failed as implementations of Islamic law. Interestingly, not rulers, but scholars tend to become rulers. I mean, not rulers in the past were never scholars, and scholars were never rulers. It was sort of a gentleman's understanding. In this case, scholars are often the head of state. So I guess that is what I was trying to cover. Thank you. Did that answer every possible question? Nothing left to discuss? I wouldn't be surprised, but...
We have time for perhaps one question, maybe two. Just be sure to keep your questions brief, because we need to move on to the next speaker.
They are being strict. Did we start with him?
I don't think I really need this.
Oh, okay.
But,
all right.
What, in the colonial period, what was the role of the consular courts in the transformation? I gather, especially in Egypt, the Western powers got together and set up these courts to which locals could gain access through various subterfuges, but I don't know what substantive law they apply.
Right. Yeah, if you, after the Ottoman Empire, say if you're looking at the mid-20th century, Egypt regained control of its legal system after a long English colonization control. Why didn't they simply readopt Sharia? Why didn't they take Sharia, write it, or as a, in lieu of that, take Sharia and write it up as a law? And many did want to do that. But the reason you gave was the reason they couldn't. There's still so much power pressure from Western powers. By then, Egypt was indebted to them and so forth. There was a very long history, I forget how many decades, of a court called the Mixed Courts, where there was amalgamation of all those consular courts, and people could look forward to a very sophisticated civil law adjudication. So this great legacy of westernization of Egyptian law was already far gone. So there's no way they could dial back the clock, nor would the Western powers allow it. So this great Sanhuri, the fellow who wrote the Egyptian Civil Code, which is so influential, you know, schooled himself on Islamic principles to the extent he could and tried to pick and choose among civil law precepts, but ended up writing a civil law code, which he himself attested later was pure civil law. But he was clearly influenced by Islamic jurisprudence, but that's what the best he could do. And he had to weather a lot of criticism because of it. But his particular compromise, which wasn't particularly on the side of Islamic law, but rather very much on the side of civil law, was the solution that allowed them to get past that impasse and also has been the model for many other states. Arab states, Libya, Syria, Iraq, Kuwait to some extent. Many, and the jurisprudence is written about this code and it's hugely influential. So that, in a way, is the secular jurisprudence of the Arab world and as opposed to the Islamic, which, of course, remained viable mainly in the family law area.
So we do need to use the microphones for the purposes of the recording. We'll take one final question for Professor Vogel.
Can you talk a little bit more about Indonesia being a secular state, please?
There might be. I hesitate because Indonesia is an ocean that one approaches from the shore. I had barely made a beach holiday. And so I feel quite ignorant of Indonesia no matter what I've read. It's a very important field. I don't know whether any of my colleagues feel they know more. What's your specific question about it?
Because I know they did a recent decentralization law, and a lot of the local governments are now instituting Sharia regulations.
Well,
and so.
Yeah, no, this is very important. Those countries that I mentioned, these pluralist and non-denominational states, some of them are federal states, Nigeria and Malaysia and Indonesia. States are using that means to institute Islamic law within the provinces, which they would not otherwise be able to do. So as you know, northern Nigeria has adopted Islamic law in a number of the northern states, leading to clashes, constitutional clashes, political clashes, and social clashes with the south, which is largely Christian, and the same phenomenon in Indonesia. Several states have adopted full-throated Islamic law, or attempted to, Aceh. And so these things are burning at the local and provincial levels. And then political parties can use one of these states as a stepping stone to bring claims at the national level for the reintroduction of Islamic law. So it's a way to undo the compromises made usually under colonial aegis, particularly in the case of Nigeria. Thank you very much.
So three quick comments on that. First of all, I hope you were edified by that wonderful, succinct introduction. Second of all, I know that I was terribly embarrassed to find, or for my students from Islamic Law who've taken it with me, who are in the audience, for them to see quite how little of what I taught them was original and how much of it came from Frank Vogel. And third, I was thrilled to disagree with him about something. That's from Muhammad? Oh, we're going to hear from Muhammad. Father will be coming soon. But he didn't teach me anything. Oh, the Prophet Muhammad. Oh. Well, you're the one who told me whatever he taught you. So, thirdly, I disagreed with Professor Vogel on Indonesia, actually. Because do they say in their constitution that they are a secular state the way Turkey does?
No, I didn't say they are. Did Pancasila?
It's not state.
No, I know you didn't, but that's why I wouldn't quite.
No, I don't think that's.
Okay, all right. All right. Just want to show you that we don't agree on everything, that's all. I do have an independent mind at some level. So, but what, more importantly, a terrible omission in my introduction, and it's terrible for many reasons. First of all, because he's sitting right over there, Professor Michael Broyde, braved the thunderstorms from Atlanta to come up and speak to us about Jewish law in the United States, and specifically Jewish courts, Beit Din courts, or whatever other version of Jewish adjudication tribunals there are in the United States.